refuse to give ourselves to principles, we cut short our own lives.
When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when, by his own evil desire, he is dragged away and enticed. Then, after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Don't be deceived, my dear brothers. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruit of all he created.
Yeah, so we started looking at the fundamental difference between trial and temptation. And basically, what I was trying to say, and I repeat it, is that trial is usually from God. Temptation is from the devil. And just to further say that trials usually come to test our faith. So anything that you profess, you'll be tested on. Jesus said, count the cost before you take a step. One of the things that God is going to do and he keeps doing in our lives is to test what we say, our profession in him. So for instance, if you declare, whether it's in your closet or a church or in an open place, that Lord, I love you, you're not going to go scot-free. That love will be tested. If pastor is making an altar call and he says that we need 5 people to come and dedicate themselves to the evangelistic ministry, and you get up and you come, you will be tested. Maybe whilst you're sitting there, you're thinking that, well, evangelistic ministry usually meets on Thursday evenings. Thursday evenings, I'm free. So that should be okay. And you don't think about the fact that God might change Thursday evening to Wednesday or to Saturday or to Sunday after church, and you just get up and come. You realize that just as you make that commitment, the whole thing changes from Thursday. And the Bible says that he who puts his hand into the plow and removes it is not fit. And all the men who attain notoriety, those who attain a great place with God, were people who faced trials and they won. I'll give you a typical example. It's a very terrible one, but that is the truth. What is his name? The son of Gilead. It's just gone off your head. It's gone off mine too. Yes. Jephthah. And Jephthah said, I love you, God. I want you to win my battle for me. And if you win my battle for me, the first thing that comes out of my house, I'll sacrifice it to you. And guess what? It's his daughter that came out. That doesn't mean that we should shy away from making vows and promises. It only means that we should think it through properly, and when we've done it, we should stick by it, because definitely our faith will be tested. But the interesting thing is that if you don't pass, you stay where you are. And that is why you see some people grow very quick in church. Others have been in church for 20 years and they are still there. It's the same principle with secondary school. You go to secondary school, you see somebody who could give birth to you. In the same class, you find out that last year, he failed his promotion. Last 2 years, he failed his promotion. Now all his children are coming to meet him in the same classroom. Whereas temptation is there to entice us to sin. And anytime we are enticed to sin, what then next happens is that we become short of the glory of God. We don't stay where we are. We go down, 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 down. And he says that, don't be deceived, my dear brothers. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heaven. Now, James puts it so beautifully. When he uses Jesus Christ, we use a language like, verily, verily I say unto you, truthfully I say unto you. He is using a word that, don't be deceived, he uses a lot. Basically, what he's affirming is that I know what I'm talking about. I have lived with the guy, possibly shared the same room with him. That's my senior bro. Are you getting my point? And I'm telling you the truth of the matter. Every good thing, that is why I don't believe in lucky. And if you're a child of God and use the word luck, you should stop using it. It's paganism. It is for 80s. Those who believe that there is no power anywhere else, they use that kind of language. Are you honest? I was lucky, pa. I was lucky, I got a decent. I was lucky. It's very demonic. Never use that language. Are you understanding it? If you believe in God, then you know that there's nothing like luck. Every good thing happens to believers before because there is a God who orchestrates it. And bad things also happen because there's a devil who is behind it. So tell people not to use that language. If you use that language also, you're not appreciating God. In a way, you are telling God that you are not responsible for my success. I see a lot of Christians use it. And when I hear, I tell them, don't say that. Some even use it for me. Oh, you are lucky. You've got good elders. I say, I'm not lucky. I am blessed. Hallelujah. Somebody tells you are lucky, tell the person, hang on there. I am not lucky. I am blessed. And that's the language you should use. Because every good and perfect gift comes from God. So when something good happens to you, you should not even argue it out. You should not even discuss it. Immediately you should know that it's coming from God. Hallelujah. So it's not a question of somebody being lucky. Lucky numbers. Oh, interesting thing about numbers. But we'll talk about that later. All right. So let's see this segment. 18, it goes on to say, so every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heavenly light, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. I can preach on this for 2 years and unveil lots of revelation in that alone. If he says that he has made you the first fruits of creation, it means that creation does not make any decision unless it takes cue from you. I repeat. Creation does not make any decision unless it takes cue from you. And God is not in the business of messing or interfering with the things of man unless he has to really, 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 really. That is why I personally believe he's not interested in football. Because if he's interested in football, Ghana should have won the game with Uruguay. Yesterday, I watched the match again. And all the emotions I felt then came back. And I'm very happy that that guy has been suspended. I think it's a payment against what he did to Ghana. How can a keeper turn into a footballer turn into be this? Every evil you do, it chases you. All the people who died as a result, those who had heart attack, their ghosts have come together, hunted him to Liverpool, and now he's been given 20 match ban, 8 matches, and what? Yes, another case is going to happen. We'll give him some more. But anyway, I'm preaching the word of God. You know, I have to stop because my wife is not laughing. Every time my wife doesn't laugh, I'm in trouble. Anyway, but seriously. Okay, it's all right. Cool. Amen. God is good. Where was I again? Say it again. Yes. Exactly. It doesn't. So you got to understand, when God created man, what did he do? He said he brought all the animals to man. and a man had a name. You understand? And where we brought me to the football thing is, I was talking about God. He does not intervene. You see, you have to understand some things. And I must say it carefully so I communicate right, because sometimes without communicating right, people misunderstand you. God is involved in the affairs of men, but there are a lot of things that he stands behind and watches us, because that is the principle he has placed. You understand? So for instance, I was saying the other day that God even has structures that work against him. But because he's God, he's able to handle it. For instance, he giving us our will. We use our will to decide against him. Are you getting my point? We use our will to decide against him and do stuff against him. But that was his principle. You getting my point? He could have made us all into robots. But that is his principle. So he lives by that. And he knows how to handle it. So God doesn't make mistakes. Don't misunderstand me. But he has put in structures in place. And some of the structures is that we control the earth. He has given the earth as his footstool to the sons of man for us to inhabit. So he creates Adam and he says to Adam, you are the first fruit of creation. All the animals I give to you, you name them, you make a decision. You till the ground, you control things. You understand? And a lot of us are messing up with our world. We have ozone layer, all these things happening. This is not the doing of God, this is the doing of man. At the end of the day, we have that responsibility to be able to do stuff the way he wants us to do it. But sometimes, obviously, we disobey him, and so on and so forth. But this test he's talking about is very powerful. In other words, creation has been predisposed or pre-instructed to obey you. And that is why everything is under your feet, including cockroaches and rats and spiders. Are you understanding that? Yes, because some of us, when we see common spider, somebody saw a spider and he jumped into the armpit of his wife. And I'm asking, who should protect who? Somebody was in the lift with his wife and family, and the lift got jammed. And he started screaming. And the children were cool. Screaming. And finally, when the thing got open, he got traumatized. He doesn't go on the lift anymore. But that is life. I didn't say that the person is Pastor Shadrach. But that is life. That is life for you. We are supposed to be on top. First of creation. Hallelujah. But let's look at this segment. 18, 19 to 27. Take the whole thing.
Verse 19. My dear brothers, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. For man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. If anyone considers himself religious and yet does not keep a tight rein on his tongue, he deceives himself and his religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world.
Let's take it one by one. My dear brothers and sisters, for that matter, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to be angry. It's very clear. I don't need to go into detail. And then he goes on to say, for man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. You see, that is why me as a pastor, you as a pastor, you as a church member, you as a child of God, you as a priest, whoever you are, you have to understand that before the cross, you could be angry about certain things. It says that Ezra was so angry about the lifestyle that was going on in Israel that he tore his beard, tore his clothing, became wild for what has gone on, Jeremiah and the rest. But post Christ, I mean post the cross, things have changed. And so we don't have to be angry about things that are unnecessary. Because listen to me, church, sinners are always going to be sinners. I have come to a place in my life personally that I really, really enjoy my Christian life. Because I realize that as a pastor, if you frustrate yourself about the way church members behave, you will end up on high blood pressure tablets. And you might even die, and they will still be sinning. Before you were born, they were sinners. Now that you are alive, there are sinners. When you die, there will still be sinners. Why do you? And that is what he's saying, that the righteousness of God does not, the anger of man does not work the righteousness of God. In other words, we need to walk in love, correct people in love, tell people where they're going wrong, tell them where they should change, and if they don't, get on with your life. You see, some people become so concerned about people that they trail them, they go to their house. Let me tell you something. If the person is going to do it, he is going to do it. Go and sit in his house. When you walk away, the woman will come after that. Seriously. And you see, a lot of us have become busybodies, just concerned about other people's life. Listen to me, church. There is judgment. Unfortunately for the believer, judgment doesn't start when we die. Judgment starts here on earth. Somebody said heaven and earth is here on earth. I believe it. I believe it so strongly. You might say, oh, that is a stupid philosophy. No, the Bible talks about kingdom of God is here. We sing it, isn't it? We declare that the kingdom of God is here. And where is it? It's among you. And hell is here. Are you getting my point? And so, God told Noah, he says that from this time on, something's going to happen to the earth. There'll be seed time and harvest time. So just make sure that what is truth, you stand for it. And you don't use your anger to judge God's righteousness. No, it doesn't. It doesn't. Somebody told me that, hey, you have to check when somebody's pregnant. Then I said, hang on a minute. Out of 30 women, out of 100 women, one gets pregnant and you want me to kill the person? Do you know how many people are doing stuff with their legs? That pregnancy has not resulted. Are you understanding that? It doesn't mean that we entertain stupidity in the church. But at the end of the day, you got to understand that your anger does not work the righteousness of God. That is the truth of the matter. And James is saying that, I am not my brother. That is why Jesus could embrace prostitutes. In fact, he spent more time with non-believers or non-believers, people who were not part of the commonwealth of Israel, more than he spent with those people. And you know what? Check your Bible. You realize that he criticized the Pharisees and the Sadducees more than those people called sinners of this day. He rather embraced them. He went to the pubs with them, drank with them, ate with them, did stuff with them, and the Pharisees accused him many times. Why? Because he came to a realization that it is love that will win people. It is love that will win people. So you be angry and blasting and say, hey, you know, those days when we become born again first, we call something blasting. You know, just tell them, I'm going to blast and burn, and you're going to hell, and everybody that smells, look at you, Jezebel, look at your mouth, look at your lipstick, it's so deep, 3 millimeters deep. And it rather sends people away from God. And remember, Jezebel's thing was in makeup. She masqueraded herself, painting her face to look strange and fearful. We did those things, but we thank God we grew out of it. We came to the realization that truly, James is speaking the stuff here. The wrath of man, I like the King James version of it. See, the wrath of man does not work the righteousness of God. I don't want to talk to him because he drinks. I don't want to talk to him because he's a womanizer. I don't want to talk to him because this is the... But do you know the Christian brother who is next to you, what he does? He comes and he lifts up holy hands and looks all pious and sanctimonious. And you know what he does? He's going to show you in a minute what he does. And you'll be amazed by what he says over there, because that is a very, very interesting concept he puts in there. So number one, he gives us a whole new meaning to Christian approach. Number one, he says that the wrath of man does not work the righteousness of God. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. So teach people the truth. Open up. Live a right life. All you can do to someone is that live right. All you can do to someone is that love the Lord. All you can do to someone, you can't put a gun to their head. You can't follow them to their house. You can't follow them to their home. What they do with their home. What they do with their money. Look, Ananias and Sapphira sold a piece of land, gave the impression to the church that this money will bring in everything. Peter looks at them, first Ananias and then later on Sapphira, and he said, are you sure? He said, yeah. We pledge this amount, we bring it into the church. He said, why have you let the devil fill you? This is a believer, a tongue-talking believer. Believer. He said, why have you let the devil fill you? And you've lied not to man. You've lied to the Holy Spirit. Peter didn't go, I curse you, I curse your descendants. And he just spoke the truth. Demonstration of love. God took over. Judgment is not after death. A lot of us, what we go through is judgment, but because we don't have insight and discernment, we think the devil is fighting us. I repeat, a lot of us, what we go through is judgment. But because we don't have discernment, we think the devil is doing stuff. And a lot of times when we pray, we're casting God, but we think we're casting the devil. Sometimes we're casting ourselves. I come against you, devil. My toe. I come against you. It is your toe, and there's no devil in there. That's the truth. Ananias and Sapphira. Ananias died immediately. Heart attack. Then Sapphira also came. They collaborated. Also said the same thing. I said, he said, look, this is the footmarks of the men that carried your husband away, and they are ready to carry your body too. And then, boom, heart attack. And she also carried away. Now, somebody will say that, but Ananias and Sapphira does not happen anymore. It happens so. It happens, but God has a diplomatic way of dealing with it. Remember, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. His principles are the same, except that his outworkings are different. Are you getting my point? So he said that you've got to be able to look at your life. The moral field, take it out. Take the evil out. Humbly accept the word that is planted in you, which can save you. A lot of us reject the word. But you know what I noticed in the church? A lot of us reject first the messenger, so they then reject the word. And even though we are supposed to take the word, now allow me to tell you this. You have a child like Levi or like Gabriel or any of these children in this house come to say exactly what I'm saying, and he will not be taken serious. Yet I will say it. It will be taken serious. You may even have an elder say something and he may not be taken serious. And I will say it and I'll be taken serious. It's not because the word is not powerful. It is the source it came from. Because we have brought ourselves to the place in the church where we accept people before we accept the word they carry. And that is why the word is not having effect in our lives. But if we will learn to accept the word, Bible says the ungrafted word of God, regardless, then it will really, really help us. You understand my point? And that is the fact. I'll give you typical examples. There are people who are preaching messages that are attracting thousands and thousands and thousands of people. There are others who are preaching, in fact, better revelations, better messages, and they only have 5 or 6 people that sit under them. Why? Because you must be of a certain caliber before people will listen to you. If you are not of that certain caliber, then nobody. And he calls it moral filth. Because the word of God is no respecter of persons. And you come to it in a minute. You've got to be able to say to yourself, in studying God's word, that Lord God, whoever it is, pastor is dealing with hundreds of people. Hundreds of people. The man, no matter how powerful he is, cannot have a word for every person. Even Jesus, the Bible says he went around doing good. But check, when he left, there were people he didn't heal. The apostles had to heal them. The man that sat at the beautiful gate, he has sat there for how many years? Jesus only ministered there for 3 years, but he has sat there more than 3 years. Meaning Jesus saw him all the time. He didn't heal him. There are lots of people he didn't heal. The apostles had to come and heal. You understand? So you got to understand that the brother next to you may have a word that will save your soul. The sister next to you, that's what the Bible says, that among the counselors, multitude of counselors, there is safety. There is safety. But I can also understand that people have used their tongue in a different light, and that causes problems. And that is what he alludes to. That is what he's developing his thesis gradually, and we're coming there. You understand? So he goes on to say that you got to understand the righteousness of God, of man, and the wrath of man doesn't work the righteousness of God. And he says, take away the moral filth. Accept the word that it will do a work in you. And 22 says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in a mirror. And after looking at himself, goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. Now remember, in those days, mirrors were scarce. So it's not a question of you see yourself in this mirror, the next minute you see yourself in another mirror, the next minute you see yourself in another mirror. Poor people don't even get an opportunity to know how they look like. They have to go to the river and see. And even that, because of the, they don't see properly. Today we have mirrors everywhere, so we take this scripture for granted. But understand, it's a cultural implication. In other words, when you get an opportunity, sometimes a lifetime opportunity, to see how your face is like, keep that memory. Don't lose it. Because you might never get the opportunity ever again. Do you know that in Africa, some of the things that sold our brothers and sisters were mirrors? The white men would come, the merchants would come with mirror, just mirror, and they would show it to the king. And the king said, And they said, how many human beings do you want? I want a whole village. Don't worry, call the warriors. You know, sometimes, let me be controversial here. Sometimes we get angry that the white man came to enslave us. That's not true. That's not true. We enslave ourselves. It was a battle between the strong and the weak. The people that came, they used their mind. They used their tactics. They know we already divided. And they play our division against us. And you think that spirit is gone. It's still there to today. They're still using our division against us. That is the truth. So they go to the kings and they tell them this, when they bring them gunpowder, mirrors and things like that, then they go and then take a whole village, a whole weak people, and then send them out as slaves. The kings themselves were not taken into slavery. No. They saw that it was a trade. Sometimes they call it barter trade. They bring stuff, mirror. So you can understand, even up to 200 years, how mirror was such a powerful commodity. So now throw your mind back to 2000 years ago. People didn't have mirror. So you have to understand. So he's saying basically that when you see your face, you might not be able to see it ever again. If you happen to go to the king's palace and for some reason you get an opportunity to see your face, he said, cherish that moment. Keep that image in your head. But if you don't do it, it's the same like the word. You are like somebody who hears the word and go about and forget it. In other words, anybody who then sees the face in the mirror, they cherish it till the next time they see another mirror. So he says, do the same. Just as, like I repeat myself, we in this generation will not understand it because mirror is very, very common. But understand that those days it wasn't. So if you get an opportunity to see your face, you got to cherish that moment. You got to cherish that image. You got to keep it all the time. You see, the same way, you got to be able to keep the word, the engrafted word. Anytime revelation comes, write it down. Buy the CD. Buy the tape. Make sure it stays with you for a very, very long time because that revelation might not come back again. Hallelujah. It might not come back again. So that is it. Glory to Jesus. So today we might not use mirror because mirror is a very common thing. What we opportunity to dine with the president of America or with the queen. Special opportunity. Yes. He said, don't forget that moment. Cherish it for the rest of your life. Everywhere you go. Yes, I had opportunity to dine with the president of America. I had opportunity to dine. Something that happens once in a lifetime thing. Put it the same way. In the same way, when revelation comes, that should be your attitude. And he says that, and after looking at himself, goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. Nobody looks himself in the mirror and forgets. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. Do you understand that? So basically, that's what he's saying. So he contrasts that person who sees his face in the mirror and appreciates it with the person who sees his face in the mirror and does not appreciate it. And say, if then you hear the word and you focus your eyes on it, you realize that that word brings freedom. And freedom will cause a great blessing to your life. You realize that Christianity is sweet and wonderful. Christianity is powerful. Christianity is not what a lot of people have made us to believe. Christianity is not God seated on the throne with a big cane on his left hand and a board and a chalk. And anytime you do any mistake, he's done it again. He's done it again. He's done it again. No. It says if you're able to allow the word of God to work and work in you, to give you that constant reminder of how you look like, you will be blessed. And it goes on to say that that freedom that it gives will bring a blessing, and that blessing will never go away. Then James throws us into the deep. Somebody say deep. This is where we might stay for about another week or so. He said, if anyone considers himself religious, basically say if you consider yourself spiritual, having loved the Lord and all that comes with it, and yet does not keep a tight rein on his tongue, he deceives himself and his religion is worthless. Basically, what he's saying is that don't be deceived by people who go shando. Look out your lip, what they say. If somebody cannot keep their lip tight, their tongue tight, they don't, you know, people today, gossip. They say things they have no clue about. They can talk about, one day somebody will talk about somebody, and the man will go like that. And you will stay there until that person comes and lay hands on you. And there are some people, they have no fear for God, no fear for church, no fear for man of God, no fear for anything and anybody. And they can talk anyhow. What they have not seen, they say they have seen. And what they have rather seen, they didn't talk about, they say they haven't seen. It's a confused world. And he says that you've got to keep a tight rein on your tongue. If you don't do that, your religion is worthless. Then he goes on to say, religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. Now, if you don't know, this will confuse you a bit. heart, he can jump from tongue and talk about looking at widows and stuff. Basically, what he's trying to examine in his test to the Jewish audience is this, that there are lots of people, instead of acting the word they have heard, they rather talk about it, and they talk about it in a negative sense. So the word that they have heard does not help them. Because you remember, what is done there is what we call progression of thought. So he's progressing his thought as he develops his thesis. And he said earlier on that you got to be able to look at yourself in the word and live it. First he says that whatever you hear, you should do. Then he says that if you don't, you are like somebody who looks himself in the mirror and forgets how it looks like. Because actually when you look at yourself in the mirror, you shouldn't forget how it looks like. And he puts it at par with the word of God. That when the word of God comes a revelation, don't. Then he goes on to say, what is religion? What is spirituality? Spirituality is ability to control the tongue. In other words, talk less, do more. For there are too many that make noise. Empty barrels that make noise in the church. And sometimes I personally despair. And honestly, I do. Because you find somebody that you think is very spiritual and very somebody mature, thank you. Somebody very spiritual and somebody mature, and they begin to see, what is this? And you're surprised. You're like, no. You can't do that. You just cannot do that. Are you understanding it? You know, somebody came up to me and he said to me, God said to her that nobody should carry my Bible, but she has been ordained to carry my Bible to the pulpit. I said, hey, I didn't know God was so much interested in who carries my Bible like that. Are you understanding it? Within a month, she was gone from church. What happened to the carrying of the Bible? And we didn't put gun to your head. You came voluntarily. Whether a cockroach talked to you or a mouse talked to you, we don't know, but you said it's God. But that is the thing. We talk big. We act big. We say things and say, no. Keep a tight rein on your lip. Process information. Certain things, you've got to know how to talk about it. Declare it, and you declare, you stand by it. You have to be a man whose yea is yea and whose nay is nay. If you're not ready to do it. Don't talk about it. And if you talk about it, you must act it. If you say you love somebody, you must act it. Are you understanding it? You went to the altar and you said, till death do us part. Truly, death should do you part. It is as simple as that. And God says that it is them that have true religion that are able to handle. And they don't say things anyhow. When they say that you are my father, they mean it, you are my father. When they say that this is my church, they mean it. When they say that God says that I should carry your Bible, they mean it. Even if you're kicking them, that's why some people like Elisha were so blessed. Because can you imagine, Elijah was discouraging Elisha every bit of the way. But Elisha would not let himself be discouraged. He could have walked away and said, well, I didn't go for the blessing because even the person I was serving, he didn't appreciate me. And look, when we got to Gilgal, he was telling me, what have you done against me? I should go. He said, I should go. I'm going. No. He said, no, I'm not going. He said, I'm not leaving you. I have only one father. I am not leaving you. And he said, what have you done? What have I done against you? I said, you don't know. I'm coming. We're going to Gilgal. We're going to Bethel. We're going everywhere. And finally, they came to them and said, what do you want? What do you want? He said, I want a double portion of your spirit. And I said, okay, then, if you see me, go. In other words, what you have begun, if you complete it. But a lot of us began and we never complete. So we are not men and women of integrity. That is what he's saying. He's lived with his brother, and he knows that his brother is very, very conscientious. He's very, very particular about those who declare things and those who don't, who declare things and they live it through, or they see it through, and those who declare things and they turn back on it. And say, so it is those who declare things and they see it through, they get the reward. And that is the thing. I will be bold even and tell you that there are people in other churches that will never be blessed unless they leave. Because they declare some things in FCR or wherever they were, and they didn't see it through. And you got to understand the principle that if you don't keep a rein on your tongue, it goes against you. And then later on next week or next 2 weeks, we'll look at it and you see that now the tongue is the rudder. And every big vessel in the air, on the sea, has a rudder. An aeroplane's one is the thing at the back. It's not for design, you know. It's not for beauty. Some of you think it's beauty. It's not. That thing that sits at the top of the fuselage. When you turn it this way, it decides the direction the plane should go. Now, with the ship, you don't see it, but you see the sea. Just underneath, also the back. And the propeller goes like this, and it's just by the propeller like that. Also, when it turns, then it's going to show us that the tongue is like the rudder. And anywhere it turns, that is where the ship goes. And it's going to demonstrate to us that the direction of your life is based on your tongue. So anybody who doesn't know how to keep rein on his or her tongue will not be successful in life. And that is one of the reasons why people are chasing their tails in the body of Christ. And again, let me emphasize it. This is Jesus' brother. All the apostles spent 3 years with him. He spent almost 33 years. He lived with the guy, grew up with the guy, criticized the guy, and finally accepted the guy. So his testimony, you must listen to.
Our mission is raising overcomers, setting the captives free. Freedom Center International is here to support you in every step that you take with the Word of God as you seek spiritual and emotional wholeness. And we hope you've been blessed by today's message. Worship with us at 38 Upper Wickham Lane, Welling, Kent, DA16 3HF, or give us a call on 0207 277 8700. You can also visit us online at fcichapel.org. And remember, there is progress in freedom.